Hello, and welcome to Engineering Economy. This is Dr. Ali Kammerdiner. We will talk today about how to make economic decisions. In particular, we will discuss types of problems. We also will talk about the role of engineering economic analysis. We discuss problem-solving and decision-making process. And we also will talk about ethical dimensions in engineering decision-making. So we have the following learning objectives. We will distinguish between simple and complex problems. We will understand the role and purpose of engineering economic analysis. And we will apply problem solving and decision making process. We will understand ethical dimensions of decision making. And last but not least, we will solve simple problems associated with engineering decision making process. So let's go ahead and get started talking about engineering economy. What it is? Engineering economy is all about making decisions. And it is based on systematic evaluation of the cost and benefits of proposed technical projects. The principles and methodology of engineering economy that are utilized to analyze alternative uses of financial resources, particularly in relation to the physical assets and operation of organization. And to put it in simple terms, we want to look at alternative uses of different resources that a company has, maybe a plant or some type of equipment. And so we can use those resources in different projects. So we're going to compare the utility of the projects and especially focus on using the available money to see whether this is economically feasible or it's not economically feasible, and which of the projects uses better economic outcomes. So let's take a look at a simple example of how 100 a month can grow. So if you have 100 each month and we deposit this 100 of each month in an account that earns 0% interest, so no interest at all, it simply would have $1,200 because there's 12 months and we deposit 100 each month. And so through 5 years, that would be 5 times 1200, so 6,000. In 10 years, we'll have 12,000 and so on. And in 25 years, we would have $3,000. Well, if we have more than 0%, if we actually have an interest on the account and the money is earning the interest, then we would have more. So you can see that in just 1 year, we have an additional $6. In 5 years, we have additional $150 just by simple 1%. And in 25 years, we have an additional over $4,000. Again, if we have larger percentages, 3% or 6%, you can see that in 25 years, we can have as much as over $44,000 versus $30,000 with no interest for 3%. And for 6%, we have almost $70,000 versus $30,000 with no interest, or over $44,000 in at 3% interest. And of course, if you have even larger percentages, you can see that the money grows very significantly. So you can compare and appreciate in 25 years, rather than having simply $30,000, at 9%, you will have over $100,000, and at 12%, it's almost $200,000. So as you can see, the interest makes a big difference in terms of how $100 a month can grow. So now let's take a look at another example. And so this example will illustrate to you the timing of the financial resources, right? So the previous was different conditions, right? We looked at different conditions of how we're using the financial resources. Now we're looking at similar use of financial resources, but we focus on the timing. And so this example is when we're using two people. So we have William and Richard. And so William started investing early and also stopped early. So William started investing at age 20 and then stopped investing at age 25. And again, he was investing $2,000 per year for just 6 years at a monthly rate of $166.67. And so his total investment at the end, right, at the end of his investment period, which is age 25, is just $1,200. And so this example will illustrate that $200 can exceed $70,000, right, based on the timing. So now William did not take out this $12,000. Instead, it let it sit there at an interest rate of 12%. And so by the end, which is at age 60, he had over $1 million, and actually $1 million and 78 over 78,000. While Richard did not start quite as early as William did. As a matter of fact, Richard started right after William has finished. So instead of age 25, he started investing at age 26 and then was investing throughout 60 and stopped at age 60. So his total money that he invested was $70,000. And again, he was investing at an interest rate of 12%. So annual investment was $2,000, and rather than just for 6 years at the beginning there, he was a little later, so he invested for 35 years again at this monthly rate or monthly payment. And so now at the age 60, Richard actually has $1,014,000. So you can see that there is a difference. And this illustrates that $12,000 can actually exceed $70,000 depending on the timing. So a third example is the real cost of $1,000 credit balance. So we're assuming that you have $1,000 balance on your credit card, you pay 21.99% interest rate, and you pay a required minimum payment of 2% of the balance, or $10, whichever is greater, and you make no new purchases. How much will it take to pay off the credit card, and how much will be the total amount you paid? So if we do the computations, we will see that it will take you 39 years and 7 months just to pay off at minimum payments, using minimum payment schedule. And that $1,000 that you borrowed will actually cost you $6,345. So that again illustrated the way that the money can grow and how dangerous it is to accrue this kind of debt and then do not pay it early, right? So the focus is pay it off early if you can. And then another example is we want to talk, or another topic that we want to discuss is we want to talk about decision making and problem solving, and understand the differences between simple problems, intermediate problems, and complex problems. So the simple problems, they can be analyzed in one's hand without extensive analysis. An example is, do I buy a semester parking pass, use parking meters, or buy a bicycle? Or how often should I eat out? So these are really simple problems. The intermediate problems, they're sufficiently important to justify serious thought and action. They can be worked out in one's hand and must be organized. The economic aspects are a significant component in the analysis leading to a decision. And then finally, complex problems, they represent a mixture of economic, political, and humanistic elements. Example, several examples are selection of a president in the United States of America,
or building a nuclear power plant, right? So these problems are very complex. They're not just economic. They have other important elements. So now, what about engineering economy? Which of these types of problems, if any, does engineering economy deal with? Yes, you're right. It's intermediate problems. And this is the principal subject of this course, is to be able to solve these intermediate problems using engineering economy. So let's take a look at an example of such intermediate problem. A student is buying a car which costs $12,000. He can borrow money in the bank with 10% yearly interest rate using quarterly compounding. And the dealer offers one of two promotions: discount of $2,000 of the price of the car, or financing for 1 year with interest of 0% in four quarterly payments, $3,000 each. Which promotion should the student take? And we assume that inflation is 0%. So if you look at promotion one, we get $2,000 and then we borrow $12,000. We get discount of $2,000, so we only need to borrow $10,000. And so we're borrowing $10,000 and with interest of 10%, so we'll get $206.25, which is 5% more than just $2,500. Then we have, right, so this is four payments. So this, a purchase of the car, you're getting this borrowing $10,000, and this is the payments. So this is a very useful cash flow diagram, right? So this picture here is called cash flow diagram. So this represents you getting this $10,000, right? Borrowing this $10,000, and this is you paying off, right, in four equal payments. So this is the first payment, this is the second payment, this is the third payment, and this is the fourth payment. So you can see that all of these options are more, right, much more than just simply $2,500. So your actual payment is actually going to be this much. So next example is this promotion two. You borrow $12,000 with an interest of 0%. So because it's a 0% interest, you simply divide $12,000 by four, so you get $3,000. So your actual payment is again $12,000. So you can see that the first promotion, right, is cheaper, right? So your actual payment is a little over $10,000, while here you're paying the full $12,000. So you should select the first promotion, even though it doesn't have a 0% interest rate. So another example. And here, right, in engineering economic analysis, what is the key questions? Which engineering projects are worthwhile? Which projects should have higher priority? How the project should be designed? How to achieve long-term financial goals? How to compare different ways to finance purchases? How to make short and long-term financial decisions? So now let's take a look at examples of non-monetary factors that are also considered in engineering economic analysis. Of course, meeting customer expectations consistently is important. Another example of non-monetary factor is maximization of employee satisfaction. And then looking at maintaining flexibility to meet changing demand, because you need to be able to respond to the market. And also maintenance of desired public image. If your company is perceived negatively, then this could be quite costly because people might forego going with you and instead go with your competition. And then leveling cyclic fluctuations in production, improvement of safety and operations, and last but not least, reduction of pollutants. Pollutants. And so, of course, those are just examples. That they're not all non-monetary factors that could be considered. There's other examples that you could come up with, but you can see that some of these, again, are quite important and so need to be taken into account. So if you look at decision-making process, and we're going to represent this again as series of steps. and diagram the decision-making process. So of course, we first need to start with recognizing the problem and opportunity. And the next step, right, is to see, right, whether this problem or opportunity relates to our overall mission and objectives. Because otherwise it's not a relevant problem, it's not worth solving. So this has to be connected to overall mission and objectives. And based on this problem and opportunity, we need to define goals and objectives specific to that problem. And again, these goals should align with overall mission and objectives of the company. And the next thing is to be able to collect relevant data or gather the data that would help you analyze the problem, because the analysis has to be data-driven analysis. And also we need to identify feasible alternatives. To, that means we need to understand whether projects, what are the projects that we can do to address the problem, and whether these projects can be done with whatever resources we have. And so next step, or not really the next, but parallel was collecting the data, we also need to select the criterion to measure the achievement of the goals or objectives, like how well will this project achieve the objectives, right? So we need to select the criterion and also construct a model. And so then when we have the model and we have the data for different alternatives, we need to apply the data to understand based on the model of which alternatives is better. So to do that, we first need to predict alternative outcomes. So we're using the model and the data, we put the data as an input into a model, and we'll get an output for each of alternatives, and that output should predict alternative outcomes. And then again, right, we might need to go back and collect more data or identify different alternatives if we figure out that one of the alternatives is not feasible. And so when we are finished with this iterative process and we have all the outcomes for different alternatives gathered, then we, based on the criterion, we choose the best alternative. And as we go, we need to audit the results. As after we chose the alternative, we need to see whether this alternative really does perform as expected. And if it's not performing, we can see that there is a problem or an opportunity for improvement. And so again, that goes back to the step one. So you can see that this chart represents a decision-making process. So let's talk about rational decision-making. So first step is to recognize a problem. Example, I need to live a place to live this term. And second, define the goal or objective. I'll find a nice apartment that is not too expensive. Assemble relevant data. So what is an example? I need information on rent, utilities, apartment, age, parking, driving time to NMSU, driving time to shopping, the neighborhood, other amenities provided, swimming, table tennis, etc. And then step four, identify feasible alternatives. An example, I'll use the Yellow Pages information from friends, apartment finding services, information from NMSU, the local newspaper, and my personal experience to look for apartments and find the apartments, right, that's feasible, that makes sense to consider. And so the fifth step is selection of a criteria to determine the best alternative. Here's an example. Most important is rent plus utilities cost. I'm also very concerned about driving time to NMSU and the kind of neighborhood the apartment is in. So next we construct the model. I'll make a spreadsheet. The rows will be apartment choices, the columns the evaluation criteria, then I'll try to find to fill in the interactions between the apartments and the criteria. And this includes determining cash flows for engineering economic analysis. And the seventh step is predicting outcomes of each alternative. I'll fill in the estimated costs in the spreadsheet and rate the amenities, driving time, etc. Then I can choose the best alternative. Apartment C looks cheapest, but I don't like the neighborhood. If I pay 50 more per month for apartment B, I get a nicer neighborhood and a 15-minute drive to MSU. Maybe I'll choose apartment B. So again, the ninth step in the decision-making process is to audit the result. I did make a good choice or didn't I, right? So did I make a good choice? Do I feel happy with apartment B? After living in apartment B for 6 months, I'm very happy with my choice. But this certainly isn't the case every time. So here's another example, a wrecked car example. Bad news, you just wrecked your car. An automobile wholesaler offers you $2,000 for the car as is. Your insurance company estimates that there is $2,000 of damage to your car. The insurance company can fix the car right away in a repair shop belonging to this company. Because you have collision insurance with a $1,000 deductibility provision, the insurance company mails you a check for $1,000. The odometer reading on your wrecked car is 58,000 miles. Additional information. You have $7,000 in savings. You can buy a newer car for $10,000 with an odometer reading of 28,000 miles. After repairing the wrecked car, it can be sold for $4,500. A discount repair shop charges $1,100 and requires 1 month. A car rental for 1 month is $400. So let's take a look at this example. There are multiple options that you can do in this case. And so if you want to understand which of the options is the best, because you can't really do all of the options, you can only do one option. And so here's the alternatives. You can buy a newer car, sell now, but don't repair. So cash flow in that case. So again, you're selling the car. So so you have 2,000 plus 1,000 that the insurance paid you. So it will be 3,000 and 10,000 for a new car. So you are out of 7,000. So that's what you're gonna have after taking this alternative or taking this route. If you decide to repair now and then sell and buy the newer car, then what you're gonna do is you're gonna be paying for the repair. You're selling the repaired car and you bought the newer car. So when you add all these together, you're out of 6,500, which looks like somewhat better option, right? That you're saving $500 compared to the previous alternative. Now there's another way too. We could repair the discount shop, sell and buy the newer car. So then we need to pay $100 at the discount shop, and then sell it at $4,500, and we bought the newer car. So altogether, we're out of $5,600, which is again cheaper than this. So maybe that's actually a better way to go, is to actually repair a discount shop. And then another alternative is repair now and keep your car. If you repair now and keep your car, that only costs you $1,000. But if you repair the discount shop, then right, it will take a month for them to repair. So you will also need, not only you pay to the discount shop, which is $100, but you also need to pay for rent of the car. And so altogether it would be $500. And so you would be out of $500. So when you look and compare all these alternatives, this is minus 7,000, this is minus 6,500, this is 5,600, and this is minus 1,000, and this is minus 500. So obviously this is the very best option if you only look at the economic decision in terms of the financial. If you're not taking into account factors such as mileage, because a newer car will have lower mileage, repair shop reliability, investment opportunity for your savings, and so on, right? So all of these are not taken into account here. Just we're looking at the cash flows. Based on the cash flows, right, if that was our criteria, then you would choose this very last alternative. All right, this is our wrecked car example. Now let's talk about ethics, which is a very important dimension of economic decision making. So what is ethics? Ethics is a concept of distinguishing between right and wrong in decision making. What's right and what's wrong? Not what's the best, but what's right and wrong. So ethic includes establishing systems of beliefs and moral obligations, defining values and fairness, determining duty and guidelines for conduct. So here's a code of ethics of National Society of Professional Engineers. Engineers, in the fulfillment of their professional duties, shall hold paramount the safety, health, and welfare of the public, perform services only in the areas of their competence, issue public statements only in an objective and truthful manner, act for each employer or client as a faithful agent or trustees, avoid deceptive acts, conduct themselves honorably, responsibly, ethically, and lawfully so as to enhance the honor, reputation, and usefulness of the profession. And so you can find that at this link. You can find this information on the Code of Ethics for Professional Engineers. So let's take a look at ethical dimensions in engineering economic making. So for each of decision process step that we looked at, we, as you remember, we had 9 different steps in that diagram. We're going to look at example of ethical lapses, right? So those are pitfalls, right, that you may fall into if you're not careful. So it's important to recognize those. So first step is to recognize the problem. So what is an example of ethical lapse in this case? Looking the other way or not recognizing the problem due to bribes or fear of retribution. And then another step, the second step, is to define goals and objectives. An example of ethical lapse in that case is favoring one group of stakeholders by focusing on their objective. The third step is assembling relevant data. So when you're gathering the data, you can make some ethical lapses. For example, you might use faulty or inaccurate data, right? If you're pressured on time and you only have some inaccurate data, you might fall into using those inaccurate data. So that could be very dangerous because it's an ethical lapse. And then decision process step 4 is to identify feasible alternatives. Example of ethical lapse is leaving some legitimate alternative out of consideration, right? There might be some good alternatives and you're just gonna look the other way and don't consider them, right? That would be an ethical lapse. The fifth step, right, in the decision-making process is a selection of criteria to determine which alternative is the best. An example would be considering only monetary consequences when other significant consequences may exist. So another steps that we had is step 6, which is constructing a model. So if you're using a short horizon that favors one alternative over another, that would be example of ethical lapses. And in reality, that is quite common in business where some managers are so focused on performing their best or proving the best performance in the short term, they sometimes do it at the expense of long-term objectives, and that could be very detrimental for the performance or overall long-term performance of the company. And so again, it's very important to understand, right, that and really focus on what is the correct horizon rather than what's the horizon that would be, you know, you might be pressured to fall into this quarterly, have some good quarterly results or yearly results, and it could be at the expense of more long-term performance and well-being of your company. So again, this is a very important example of ethical lapse, and it's actually quite common. So another step is step 7, which is predicting alternative outcomes. An example of ethical lapse in this case is using optimistic estimates for one alternative and pessimistic ones for the other alternatives. For step 8, choosing the best alternative, an example of a lapse would be choosing an inferior alternative, one that is unsafe or at unnecessary costs for the user or might harm the environment. So again, maybe economically, this alternative is very, very best. But long term, if you look at the cost to environment, it might be right that right now there is no loss to protect the environment for this specific case. And so it might be really offering a very low cost, but that would be an ethical lapse not to consider the environment, especially if it really harms and where the harm is difficult to address. And so step 9 would be the last step in the decision-making process, and that's auditing the result. And a very common ethical lapse is hiding the past mistakes. So you're auditing the results and you're noticing past mistakes. You gotta address them. You can't hide them because that would be unethical. All right, so this is what we have in terms of ethics. And we know how well and how honestly the decision-making process is conducted, the data, method of analysis, recommendations, and follow-up, right? It's all important in terms of recognizing the ethical issues. So recognize ethical issues exist and make them an explicit part of decision-making process. All right, thank you very much. This concludes this lecture.